Good morning. Today we are going to review the dynamics portion of the AP Physics C mechanics curriculum. You know, Newton's three laws and friction and stuff.
Don't say "and stuff." Just say Newton's laws and friction.
Flippin' physics.
Billy, what is Newton's first law?
When viewed from an inertial reference frame, an object is at rest, will remain at rest, and an object in motion will remain at a constant velocity unless acted upon by a net external force.
An inertial reference frame is where the frame of reference has an acceleration of zero. For example, right now my acceleration is zero, so this is an inertial frame of reference. A non-inertial reference frame is where the acceleration of the frame of reference is not equal to zero. For example, in a car which is turning, which is a non-inertial reference frame, objects which are at rest on the dashboard will, from the frame of reference of the vehicle, not remain at rest. Newton's first law is also called the law of inertia. And inertia is the tendency of an object to resist a change in state of motion or to resist acceleration. Bobby, what is Newton's second law?
Newton's second law is an equation. Net force equals mass times acceleration. And remember, force and acceleration are both vectors.
Yes, that is the form of Newton's second law, which I prefer, but you should be aware that it has been rearranged on the AP equation sheet to solve for acceleration. Bo, what is Newton's third law?
Newton's third law is also an equation. For every force object one exerts on object two exerts an equal but opposite force on object one, and force is, of course, a vector.
Billy, what are the units for force?
Force is in newtons, and newtons are... net force equals mass times acceleration, so a newton is a kilogram times a meter per second squared.
Bobby, name and describe one of the basic forces in dynamics, please.
The force of gravity. The symbol is F sub G, and it equals mass times acceleration due to gravity. It is caused by the interaction between the object and the planet. It is always down. Here near the surface of planet Earth, the acceleration due to gravity is considered to be a constant positive 9.81 meters per second squared. It is synonymous with weight, so sometimes you will see the symbol capital W used for weight or force of gravity. And it acts on the center of mass of the object.
Actually, it acts on the center of gravity of the object.
We live in a constant gravitational field, so the center of gravity and center of mass of an object are in the same place.
Sure.
Bo, another force, please.
The force normal, F sub N. It is a pushing force caused by a surface. It is normal to or perpendicular to the surface. The force normal is always a push, and it acts on the contact point between the two surfaces.
Billy, how about another force?
The force of tension, capital F with a subscript of capital T. The force of tension is the force caused by a rope, cable, wire, string, or the like. The force of tension is always in the direction of the rope or cable, etc. And the force of tension is always a pull, and sometimes the symbol is just capital T.
There is also the force applied, F sub A, which is just the force of one object pushing or pulling on another object. There's a lot we need to know about the force of friction, capital F sub lowercase f. It is the force caused by the interaction between two surfaces of two objects. And class, what do we know about the direction of the force of friction?
The force of friction is always parallel to the surfaces.
It opposes motion.
And it is independent of the direction of the force applied.
Yes, the force of friction is always parallel to the surfaces. It always opposes motion, and what that means is it opposes the sliding between the two surfaces. And the force of friction, the direction of it is independent of the direction of the force applied. Sometimes students try to tell me that the force of friction is opposite the direction of force applied, and this is not always true. It is true that the force applied and the direction of the force of friction are independent of one another. The equation on the AP equation sheet is the absolute value of the force of friction is less than or equal to mu, the coefficient of friction, times the absolute value of the force normal. There are two types of friction. Billy, please tell me about one of them.
Static friction is when the two surfaces are not sliding relative to one another, and that equation works out to be the force of static friction is less than or equal to the coefficient of static friction times force normal, and therefore the maximum force of static friction equals the coefficient of static friction times force normal.
Yes, the force of static friction varies in an attempt to prevent the two surfaces from sliding relative to one another. Bo, the other type of friction, please.
There is also kinetic friction, where the two surfaces do slide relative to one another. And then the equation is just the force of kinetic friction equals mu kinetic times force normal.
Bobby, please tell me more about the coefficient of friction.
The symbol for the coefficient of friction is mu. It is determined through experiments. It has no units. Its value depends on the materials of the two surfaces which are touching one another. The lowest value it could have is zero if there is no friction, and usually the maximum is about two. However, there could be circumstances like drag racing tires where mu can get up to four, but really zero to two is a normal range for the coefficient of friction. And the coefficient of static friction is greater than the coefficient of kinetic friction for any two interacting surfaces. That is why it is harder to get something moving than it is to keep something moving.
Now let's talk about free body diagrams or force diagrams. Free body diagrams or force diagrams are diagrams of all the forces acting on objects. Again, only forces appear in free body diagrams. I have five steps to help you solve any free body diagram problem. Class, step one is?
Draw the free body diagram.
Step two?
Break forces into components.
Step three?
Redraw the free body diagram.
Step four?
Sum the forces.
And step five?
Sum the forces
again. 1. Draw the free body diagram. Do not break any forces into components in your initial free body diagram. These instructions come directly from the AP College Board, so I will repeat. When you draw that first free body diagram, do not break any forces into components. Step 2. Break forces into components. Step 3. Redraw the free body diagram. Now, I know many of you are going to feel compelled to skip step number 3. Please do not. I have graded copious numbers of problems from students where they skipped step 3, where they did not take the extra 20 seconds to redraw the free body diagram, and they made simple mistakes. So please redraw the free body diagram. Steps 4 and 5 appear to be the same, but they are not. You are summing the forces in two directions which are perpendicular to one another. Billy, what are some things you must identify when you sum the forces?
Every time you sum the forces, you have to identify positive directions.
I thought up was positive and down was negative.
And right was positive and left was negative.
Yeah, that is true. I guess if the direction is not clear, you need to identify it. Like, if there's a pulley, for example.
Yeah, makes sense.
Okay.
You also need to identify which object or objects you are summing the forces on and which direction you are summing the forces in.
The only time you do not have to identify the direction you are summing the forces in is when you are summing the forces in all directions simultaneously using unit vectors. realize the only time you can sum the forces on multiple objects at the same time is if all those objects have the same acceleration. For example, if they are attached, if they are connected via a string, or if one object rests on top of another object. If an object is on an incline, we will often, though not always, break the force of gravity into its components in the parallel and perpendicular directions, and instead of summing the forces in the x and y directions, we'll tip the x and y directions so that we sum the forces in the parallel and perpendicular directions. And just so you know, theta in these equations is the incline angle. Next, let's talk about translational equilibrium. Translational motion is just when an object moves from one location to another. Bobby, what is the condition? What's the equation for translational equilibrium?
An object is in translational equilibrium if the net force acting on the object equals zero.
That means the object is not moving.
Actually, that's not necessarily true. That means the object is not accelerating.
Right, because net force equals mass times acceleration. So if the net force equals zero, that means the object has an acceleration of zero.
Which means the object is either moving at a constant velocity or is not moving at all.
But it could be not moving.
True, but it could be moving at a constant velocity.
Another force we need to talk about is the drag force, or the force of resistance. The symbol for the resistive force is F sub R, or capital R, or F sub D. It is the force of drag caused by the interaction between the object and the fluid through which the object is moving. The direction of the drag force is opposite the direction of motion of the object, and when the object is moving through the air, this is often called air resistance. For small objects moving at slow speeds, the force of drag is equal to the negative of the proportionality constant times the velocity of the object. Now, what are slow speeds and what's a small object? Really, the only way to know is to determine it experimentally. So for the purposes of the AP test, they would either have to tell you it's true or give you information and ask you to prove that it is true. Bo, please give me the equation that we use most often for the force of drag.
Usually, the force of drag equals 1/2 times capital D, the drag coefficient of the object, which has no dimensions, is experimentally determined, and depends on the shape and surface texture of the object, times rho, the density of the medium through which the object is moving, times capital A, the cross-sectional area of the object, normal to the direction the object is moving, times V, the velocity of the object, squared.
A common mistake here is to use the density of the object. Remember, rho is the density of the medium through which the object is traveling. Our last subject is terminal velocity. Billy, what is terminal velocity?
Terminal velocity is when an object moving through a fluid has reached translational equilibrium. May I derive the equation for the terminal velocity of an object which is falling downward in the atmosphere?
Sure, Billy. Go ahead.
Okay. The free body diagram of the object has the force of gravity straight down and the resistive force straight up. Summing the forces on the object in the y direction equals the resistive force minus the force of gravity, and that all equals mass times acceleration in the y direction. Substituting in equations gives us 1/2 times the drag coefficient of the object times the density of the air times the cross-sectional area of the object times the velocity of the object squared minus the mass of the object times the acceleration due to gravity, which all equals the mass of the object times the acceleration of the object in the y direction. We can divide by mass to solve for the acceleration of the object. And you can see that in the absence of air resistance, the acceleration of the object would be equal to the negative of the acceleration due to gravity, as it should, because it would be in free fall. Okay, but terminal velocity. Terminal velocity means the acceleration of the object is equal to zero, so we can solve the equation for terminal velocity, which equals the square root of 2 times mass times acceleration due to gravity divided by the quantity drag coefficient times density times cross-sectional area. There. We derived the equation for the terminal velocity of an object which is falling downward through a fluid.
Yes. However, please realize this is not the only equation for terminal velocity. This is the equation for terminal velocity in this specific case. A rocket accelerating upward, for example, would have a different terminal velocity equation. This brings us to the end of my review of dynamics. Next, you could enjoy my review of work, energy, and power, or you could visit my AP Physics C review webpage. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.